Hi, I'm Rick Roth. I'm with the Ink Kitchen, and we're doing virtual shop talks. Shop talks usually happen at trade shows, which are not particularly happening right now. So what we do is bring in people. We try not to have the traditional talking heads. We try to have people that are really in the field doing the work, and this is no exception. We have Cassie Stanczyk here, and I hope I pronounced her name right. And she is the Director of Strategic Accounts at Bella. And we're going to talk a little about supply chain issues. We're going to talk about fashion. We're going to have a good old time. And Cassie, you want to tell me a little bit about your background and so people can know where you're coming from and where you're at this moment?
Yes, certainly. First of all, obviously, thanks for having myself and Bella Canvas represented. It's a little bit different this year, but we're making the best of the situation. But yeah, so I'm the Director of Strategic Accounts at Bella Canvas, and I have been with the company in a variety of different ways for almost 13 years, which is crazy for me to say at this point. Started out on the distribution
side.
Since
you were 10 years old, that's pretty good.
I know, started at 10, so started a little bit early out there, but obviously started on the account management side on handling our distributors. I was also based in Europe for about 6 years and handled the sales and marketing aspects there. And I'm happy to be back in the U.S. working with distributors along with some of the largest strategic accounts in the industry so they can really have a full overview of everything Bella Canvas has to offer.
All right. So let's get into it here. So,
certainly.
I'll preface this by saying I think that I was finding in the early fall, people were kind of tired of, what COVID had done, and we're starting to harsh on each other. I've noticed a little bit of a switch, and I at least have been trying to change it so that everybody has a little more empathy and it can be sympathetic to people's situation. So I think part of that is to understand where people are at. So I would like to hear, I've heard a little bit, but I'd like to hear more about the challenges that Bella Canvas has had in bringing product to the marketplace so that we all maybe could maybe go a little easier on you and a little easier on everybody who is, experiencing this together.
Yes, certainly. I mean, I totally agree that, in the beginning, people were very hard on, multiple companies. And I think myself as a consumer, I'm even guilty of doing it when I experience delays in, everyday life. So it can really help put things into perspective. But obviously, Bella Canvas was, not rid of, supply chain issues, like I think almost every other manufacturer in our space. But I think it's very general in what caused this and what is still causing this. If you even just look at your own situation from where you are at in the U.S., social distancing measures, shutdowns in certain states have really just, dampened what we would normally be able to do from a supply chain perspective. So, we are headquartered in Los Angeles and have very strict social distancing measures there. So if you take how we were once able to operate our cutting facility, which is based in Los Angeles, how we were once able to operate our warehouse and logistics hub in Los Angeles is not the way that businesses in Bella Canvas is able to operate currently. So people are working on, skeleton crews in comparison to what your normal capacity would be here in the States if you have, just your warehouse or any sort of operations there. On top of it, we are trying to be extremely careful and cognizant of our employees at Bella Canvas. So we are, taking these measures extremely serious. If someone doesn't feel great or feel right, they're obviously asked to go home. And when you're down employees, you're down productivity in a way. So that's one aspect. If you take, our sewing operation, which is in Central America, it's the same situation there, but almost heightened. You have to realize that people need to come and go from work. Public transit in many of these countries is still not up and running or was not at a certain period. And so that makes things even harder. You also have extremely strict social distancing measures there as well. So just overall productivity was not, and to some degree still is not, what companies were used to working off of. So that's one aspect from the productivity standpoint. But then you can also take what's going on in logistics right now. Logistics is, also not been spared problems through this pandemic, and everyone's productivity in a global supply chain is just not able to be where it once was, which causes delays.
I would imagine that's probably like even for a small business like my own, you know, we ordered some shirts that we normally would get in 4 days and it took 22 days because UPS isn't up to speed, or we sent a sample to someone by the postal service and, you know, as try as they may, you know, certain pubs of theirs, you know, took 3 weeks instead of 2 days. And I mean, you would have the same thing. You would have a container that would be late, I would guess, and you would have some sample of patterns that needed to be sent to a factory that were delayed. I would imagine every aspect of what you do is challenging.
Right. And that's, you know, really the unique situation. Hurricane,
right?
Hurricanes, you know, also help in Central America.
Hurricanes, right?
Hurricanes, flooding. You know, they say when it rains, it pours. So, you know, that's no exception here. But it's the interesting part and the uniqueness of this entire situation is it's not just one aspect of someone's business that has been compromised, so to speak. It's every different aspect, you know, it's things that are not, you know, in your control. Obviously you talked about containers, it made national news, the LA port was backed up in a major way. So, you know, you can get the goods and produce the goods even when you're back up to speed, and then there's another roadblock. So, you know, we're working through it, and I think everyone is working through it, but I think you're totally right that people now are a little bit more understanding as the severity is, you know, kind of brought to the forefront a bit more, and you really think about it just from a personal perspective. What delays have you experienced? We all just got through holiday and Christmas, and I certainly had delayed packages. I'm sure you did, and a lot of our viewers watching. So when you can really kind of personalize it, it makes it a little bit more understanding. But to put a positive spin on this, I think another unique thing about Bella Canvas, and you know, one of the reasons we're as successful as we are is, you know, throughout this pandemic, not only were we able to, you know, survive and thrive in many ways, we've also been able to increase and, you know, really enhance our supply chain through this. So because of our efforts with masks, we expanded our cutting facility in Los Angeles in a major way. Pre-COVID, I think we were just over 50 cutting tables. And I believe post-PPE, I suppose.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, not post-COVID yet, wishful thinking. But post-PPE, we're just over 80 cutting tables that are now solely back to doing apparel. So that's really amazing and gives us a lot of excitement for, you know, supply chain to come. And we were also able to expand our overseas factories, again, all doing apparel. So everyone has to work their way out of this hole, and we're all, you know, doing it as quick and efficiently as possible. But it makes us very excited once we're really out what the future will hold because of these enhancements and increases that we've done on the supply chain side.
Yeah, it's funny how actually I've talked to a number of successful companies that have successfully weathered the storm, and you know, even the small ones that have succeeded have done what you're saying, that all right, they took the challenge and maybe that they actually improved their business as a result, you know, sort of what the heart of steel is forged in the hottest fire or something.
Totally.
It is humbling though. You know, I know you have a lot of, I don't know what you would call it, extremely capable, responsible people, you know, starting at the top with Chris Blakesley, who I know is, you know, likes to get things right. But it's very humbling, right? You normally, so if a boat doesn't come in, you put it on a plane, but all of a sudden there were no planes. Like I know that you couldn't send cargo in the normal thing. I mean, it's, I know on my level, it's been very humbling that usually you don't want to make an excuse. And even when something's bad, you can do something about it. This, a lot of things you can't do much about.
Right. But you know, Rick, it's really been, I think humbling is a good word, but it's been amazing to see so many people and companies in this industry and their resilience, right? Like you've experienced this with your companies and you know, your customers, how resilient this industry can be. So many people and so many small businesses overnight, you know, pivoted an operation or a system that they had been used to doing for years and years and years, and how flexible and agile they were able to be to really pivot and retool that operation to work with current situations and scenarios. So it's really been a bright spot. You know, I'm sure you've experienced this too, to hear stories from customers in this industry and small businesses and companies alike, what they've done to remain relevant and, you know, really just thrive through this, which has been really a really cool thing to see.
So I guess a couple things. I'd like to hear what BELLA+CANVAS is doing in terms of responding to, like, how's the market changed and how you're responding to that? And then maybe we'll get into also how you see your customers have changed and how you've had to respond to that. So
yeah, certainly. So
maybe made a few masks or, you know, something like that, right?
Yeah, made a few masks. And then again, right there with the situation I was just talking about, the resilience, the forward thinking, the creativity, you know, Danny and Marco, our owners, and Chris Blakesley really, again, retooled our operation overnight to have a very nice, you know, mask business and really help, you know, get some of the first masks in this industry out to market, which was great. But I think what we see happening, you know, back on the apparel side, because we're in full force apparel again, has really been a benefit to BELLA+CANVAS. We've seen this extreme acceleration in premium basics, which I'm sure maybe you've seen from dealing with some of your customers. It's been a, you know, an interesting ride, but I believe the current situation that COVID caused, the shift from being in an office to working from home, these Zoom calls that everyone has been doing has really brought people back to a premium basic. They're no longer in a shirt and tie and dressed up or, you know, office casual. They can wear what they would normally choose to wear. So I think that has really fueled this extreme acceleration in premium basics. And luckily enough, BELLA+CANVAS was positioned nicely to capture that. I think also we are seeing companies now that they're choosing to spend money, they're analyzing every dollar that they spend because there is still some sort of uncertainty of, you know, what the next week will hold, what the next month, what the next year will hold. So while they are spending money, which is, you know, great for our industry to see, they're spending it in a different way. So I think they think that if they're going to spend a dollar, it better be a dollar well spent. So how we're seeing that reflect on the apparel side is that free merch kind of giveaway tee is no longer right now. They want to make sure that if they're going to spend money on a t-shirt, it's a t-shirt that someone wants to wear, a t-shirt that someone is happy to get, and that they will wear over and over. You know, so again, it's taking out a big portion of that free merch category that was very prevalent in our market space.
Right. How much has the increase in online shopping, you know, what's the impact on your business for that?
So yeah, I think one current theme that you have probably heard and most people in this industry in regards to apparel have heard is e-commerce. How do we pivot to an e-com platform? Because that was really what was exploding through all of this. As people were at home, as people had more time on their hands, everyone was shopping and Googling and trying to buy. Mm-hmm. So again, from a BELLA+CANVAS perspective, it's been very, very beneficial. We are fortunate enough to have always had a very strong e-commerce platform to always be, I would say, ahead of the industry from an e-commerce and digital marketing perspective. So for us, it's just more aligned the current marketplace with our brand and what we do. But I think, again, customers have been very focused and keen on, if they weren't already on some sort of e-commerce platform, how do they shift to that? And not even so much from a platform perspective, but how do I shift my operation or what it is that I do to a virtual platform? Conferences may be no longer, but I still want to get things or information in front of my customers. How can I make my event a virtual event and still make it successful? So it's not just from a selling perspective, it's also from an event perspective. We've seen a lot of people in this industry try and still pivot from an event-based in-person activity to doing that virtually. But again, that has really helped align people with Bella Canvas because we are all about digital collateral. We're all about e-commerce space and a great platform.
I think the other thing I've seen on my end is that, you know, so we've done more e-commerce, and if you're doing an online store, the price aversion, like the price difference of a premium basic versus a, like an open end product or something, it just doesn't matter if you're selling something for $25 or $30 online. It changes things.
I think because you're going, it's almost like it's changing the consumer's mindset to where, oh, I'm just buying in the regular retail space when you're doing it online. It's almost just a shift in their perspective. It could still be someone from the wholesale industry, but it's something that happens when people are buying online that you're totally right. That price aversion seems to not be as prevalent because you're going back to your regular retail shopping habits.
I would say even with the, you know, well, where we'll do promotional work for somebody where we might have supplied it to them and I don't know how they distribute it various ways, but now we'll do it mailed out to their customers. And again, the whole price is in a package, and that extra dollar maybe for the premium product just it goes away. It's not like it's not the issue that it might have been. Maybe it's where the decision is made, or I don't know what the dynamic is, but there seems to be more appreciation for the quality of it and less aversion to the price.
Well, it's
the price difference, but for some reason people really used to focus on that and they don't seem to as much.
Yeah. And I think it's also, like you said, you're shipping directly to this person for a company, maybe, whereas before this, everyone would just go pick up a shirt at some company event. But again, I think it's that shift in perspective that when something comes to you, you're opening a package and you are able to see everything that's in it. Quality matters. People are expecting a cool gift. People are expecting a shirt that feels great. Whereas maybe before, like I said, if they were just going down the line, picking up a shirt off of a table at an event, maybe they wouldn't care so much. But when something has that personal fit and feel of a package coming to your house, that whole unboxing experience that everyone's talking about, I think it's a bit of a letdown when it's not a more premium product, regardless of if it's a hard good product or apparel. I think people, when they go to open that and they don't have a great experience, it can leave more of a lasting impression than if they're just picking up a t-shirt off of a table.
That's funny. I used to tell some of my customers, I would say, you want them to wear the shirt or you want them to wash their hubcaps with it? And you know, totally. No one's driving, so they're not going to want to wash their hubcaps. Yeah. So they really don't want that crappy shirt.
Right.
So I want to ask you a little bit about, you know, what's happening in fashion. So I'm going to tell a little story first, which is some of your compatriots, when we were at Long Beach last year, we did a shop talk and I was like, all right, what's going on out there? And they're like, well, I think, you know, they mentioned tie-dye and they mentioned sweatsuits. Right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, really? okay. And I usually trust your folks, but I went on a trip with my buddies and we went out near Joshua Tree. And the first place I stopped, there's three very fashionable women that came in dressed in tie-dyed sweatsuits.
Yep.
And then we went out into Death Valley and we didn't see anyone. And I came back to Los Angeles and the very first person at the car rental place had a tie-dyed sweatsuit on. I was like, I think they actually nailed it. You know, like, absolutely nailed it. So anyway, I have to ask after that experience, what's going on out there? What's going on? I mean, I know a few things I can tell because they're out of stock, but what's going on in terms of what people are wearing and buying? And so that might help folks out there know what trends to be plugged into.
Yeah, totally. Well, you hit on one of them, but sweatsuits. So athleisure wear in general, you'll hear us use acceleration a lot, but this pandemic has accelerated the athleisure wear market like crazy. Again, people aren't in the office, they're at home, especially from a female perspective. If given the choice, I think every lady would say they would want to wear leggings, but they can't in the workspace, and now everyone can. So fashionable athleisure wear has skyrocketed. So how that translates at Bella Canvas is our street fleece collection. So fleece in general had been trending so much for us. And again, it's through the roof. So when I say fleece, it's an elevated, right, fleece. It's our street fleece collection. So it's a very fashionable yet comfortable, silhouette driven, color driven. You're seeing matching sweatsuits everywhere right now, and a lot of play on texture. So we have a great suede collection in our forward fashion line. And we also have tie-dyes. So you're seeing all these small plays that just lend a hint of differentiation to the basic athleisure wear collection. So definitely athleisure wear, how that relates to our space. It's a great category to sell. It's not over commoditized yet. You don't have to sell on price. It's on fit. It's on feel. It's on really the retail styling of it. And it's a high margin category. So really, if you're not focusing on fleece right now, you're missing the boat. Start focusing on fleece. Bella Canvas has an awesome street fleece collection.
So funny, man, isn't it? Like 7 or 8 years ago, like the idea of selling a crew neck fleece, like you couldn't sell one. Or
How old school back then, right? You know,
right? Or a sweatsuit? Like no way. You know, that just it was. It's things got totally got turned on their head. It's funny how it goes like that.
Yeah, I think another thing that we're seeing on the athleisure wear side is, you know, it used to be that our industry really lagged the retail market, right? We lagged it by several years, and that gap is lessening and lessening. So obviously the sweatsuit trend, fleece athleisure wear is huge in retail right now. So you're seeing that also due in part to some of the acceleration because we're now more closely following what's at retail, which is awesome to see.
I wonder how accelerated it's going to get. Is there someday where there'll be like the runway in Paris and you'll take their clothes off and put them right in the Bella Canvas box? You know,
Listen, it's not that far away to think about it. You know, that's one reason why Bella Canvas introduced our forward fashion line, right? Because we didn't want to trail retail, and how our supply chain is set up with having a production in the U.S., we can quickly respond to these trends and bring them to market faster. So that's why you saw Bella Canvas with a great tie-dye addition to forward fashion. You've seen us bring some really cool athleisure wear pieces within our street fleece collection that are, again, differentiated in detail from some of our inline products. And then you're going to see us here in the next few months bring in some really cool additions to our suede collection, some really cool matching sets. So it's not too far off, Rick, because we really want to stay on top of those trends and be able to bring them to the wholesale industry much faster than what people are typically able to do.
It's so funny, actually. You know, years ago, you could not tell a customer what I tell them now. It's like, well, if you see something, I probably can get it. You know, that was not true. You know, our channel just didn't have those things like that. So what's going on color wise? I notice I can't buy anything green. Seems everything out of stock. What's going on in terms of colors these days?
Yep. So, you know, for us at Bella Canvas, color is everything. We've really become this house of color in the industry. But that is because
House of Color has black and white logo, though. That's great.
You know, totally. Keep it simple on the logo. Bring in all the fun with our shirts. But, you know, we've become this house of color, you know, in our 3001 and 3001 CBC, which are our two key core basics. I believe we're surpassing 150 colors on those. So we've really grown to be this amazing, you know, line of color, but color is everything in retail. So you see athleisure wear is one trend, but I think what you're also seeing in retail is a lot of basics, just done in a different and cool color, you know, palette. So basics are here in retail, but you're seeing a lot of these half tones, a lot of these mid tones, but several different categories that we really see trending. So shades of green is certainly one of them. We've introduced a few new shades of green for 2021. But you're also seeing like this trend of brights almost. So not neons, but done in a different way. So some almost electric colors that really translate well from a digital perspective now that everything is going digital. And we also see a lot of still these jewel tones, these mid-tones, half steps in between core colors that still seem to be doing really well. So we have a few new color categories that I just touched on that have just hit the market in all of our key core basics and also in some of our fashion pieces as well.
So funny though, it seems more like everything goes. Like it used to be, all right, now it's crew neck sweatshirts, no hoodies. But it seems like people more are able to make more different choices. It's not so rigid. I mean, you might think from what you were saying about the mid-tone colors, maybe something else like Heather's would be going out, but I it seems like it's all still possible to sell. Seems like
it's really all still possible.
A lot of different things that people are, you know, not just rigidly in the same channels.
No, I think people have become much more open. And like you said, it all still goes. I think that another interesting thing that we've seen in the industry as of late is this kind of rise in the crafter market, if you will. So people, again, are at home, more time on their hands, they're wanting to personalize, they're wanting to embellish. And so it's really bringing an end user back into our industry, which is pretty cool. But I think that kind of gives it the anything goes mentality, right? You have some people that are just going to want their basics. You're going to have some people that are, you know, enticed by some of the cooler colors. And then you're going to have that very fashion savvy end user customer that wants to personalize a shirt, and they want exactly what they're seeing on the runway. They want exactly what they're seeing in retail shops. So there's got to be a little bit of something for everyone.
So, you know, I'm on the decoration end mostly. So, you know, it's really been an explosion of a variety of decoration techniques. We have everything from, you know, putting tons of ink on to like the lightest amounts of ink to digital printing to, I mean, we're known as one of the best screen printers, but we're all about transfers now. And then we really, an important part of our business now is direct to garment. So how are some of those decoration techniques affecting what Bella is offering? I mean, I kind of know the answer, but I'm going to ask you.
Yeah, you know, obviously, Rick, you know that our founders, Danny and Marco, started out on the screen print side. So we're always very cognizant that any fabrication that we release is meant to be embellished. It's meant to be screen printed. It's meant to, you know, have some sort of decoration on it. So I think that's always a really cool fact, because we're not going to release something that doesn't have amazing printability. You're totally spot on what you're experiencing. We're hearing across the market of the demand for so many different types of printing, everything from super simple to super hardcore in terms of inks and colors. But I think that kind of goes to the fact that people want to stand out. They want to be differentiated from maybe what they were previously doing. People are maybe willing to take a few more risks if they think it's the right fit. So you're seeing all these different print techniques come to life, which is awesome from a design perspective. But yeah, certainly a rise in the DTG market. I think that's, again, been a bright spot in the industry. But I think a lot of that comes from...
Don't you have some offerings even that are specifically meant for that? Like you have a black and a DTG black or something like that, right?
Yeah, totally. So we have kind of encapsulated a DTG collection. Obviously, if you're familiar with direct to garment, typically the higher cotton content, obviously the better results. New machinery is coming into the market, which is making that kind of less important than it used to be. But certainly we've put together this capsule if you're really focused on DTG for some key core basics there. But we are also focused on that market, like you said, specifically in fleece. Fleece can be a bit challenging sometimes for DTG. So we release some DTG specific colors, which have a higher cotton content on the face. So the printability is going to give you a lot better results. So you'll find those in some of our basic hoodies and pullovers to really address the growth in that marketplace.
Yeah, I mean, it's mind-boggling for the decorators. And so when you're thinking about embellishment, the last thing you want to do is also have to decipher, you know, what garment's going to work. So I know that a lot of people are very happy with your approach to that, where you kind of take the guesswork out. And, you know, I think traditionally the garment companies in some ways were like, well, we're going to make a garment people like, and good luck, you know, decorating it. I mean, I've actually run into garments that were not able to be decorated, you know,
right.
Like one company made a Heather Gray a few years ago where no matter what you did, it scorched. You couldn't print it with any ink that I know of. So you guys assume the opposite of that, where you're really focused on making things that can be decorated, telling us exactly how to decorate them. I mean, I know the ink kitchen and, you know, my compatriots have been, you know, part of some of that. You've consulted with us, and
yeah, we, you know, again, it comes I think it comes from Danny and Marco's background, and we really want to be at this point a resource portal for our industry, to where if you have a question, you know that there's some sort of resource that Bella Canvas has produced or put out that can help you. And you know, we go to the best in our industry to troubleshoot and to make sure that the product we're putting out is a quality product. But like you said, not just from kind of your fabrication, your technical fit perspective, a styling perspective, but also from a printability perspective, because at the end of the day, right now we're servicing the promotional market. We know 9 times out of 10, these shirts are being used to be embellished or printed on. So we wanna make sure that we have that top-notch quality, both from the, like I said, the fashionable fit feel perspective all the way down to the printability perspective. So for us, that's just doing our job to put out a great garment.
Right. So I think we'll bring this towards an end. So what do you see this year? Like, anything you see that maybe people would not be aware of, that sort of, you know, your company being in Los Angeles, maybe at the forefront of these things, what's coming on next? You know, what kind of things, you know, is it going to be boxer shirts? What's going on?
Well, I think we touched on some of them. I think you're going to see a lot of, you know, small differentiation with textures, with the matching sweatsuits, a lot of play on color, you know, injecting new color. So just slight differences in existing things. But I think from a market perspective, I would say that I think people are going to be shocked at kind of what accelerates, right? I think a lot of people would tend to think that people are going to play it super safe during all of this. But I think, you know, you can probably attest to this, like you kind of have already touched on, that people are going for it. You know, they're thinking, if we're going to do something, we're going to do something that makes an impact and makes a splash. So I think we're going to be pleasantly surprised at some really cool fashion pieces coming to light and maybe selling more than they normally would have. From a decoration perspective, like you said, I think you're going to see some things come out of the woodwork, and people that typically would stay very basic might go for it. So I think you're going to see some much more fashionable things get very popular, and some companies or customers that are used to doing very basic are going to give it a shot. So for us at Bella Canvas, that always makes us excited, because we want to be the ones that bring these pieces to the forefront. So an acceleration in usage is really golden for us. So we're really looking forward to people coming on board this premium fashion ride with us.
Well, thanks a lot. That's really nice to see someone so passionate about what they do. And hopefully some of your excitement can rub off on all the rest of us that are stuck in COVID hell. So
well, likewise, thanks for having me. We always love doing this with you. You're such a resource yourself to our industry, so we love partnering with you whenever possible.
All right, Cassie Stanczyk, thanks a lot.
Thank you.